Well, thank you all. Thank you all for coming out this afternoon. Look, I know it's a busy time. It's a fall day. It's beautiful outside. I think there's a World Series or something going on. I don't know. I've heard. You know, thank you for coming out, and thank you for being here this afternoon. We all have many things to do. But when we come together like this, we build up the bonds of fellowship within the church, and it increases, you know, our own personal knowledge, but it also increases the breadth and depth of our church life. We come to get to know each other a little bit more, and those bonds of fellowship are strengthened, they increase, they grow. And those are the sorts of things, the kinds of things that carry us through in our lives. And indeed, may God grant us today in our fellowship, may he grant that we come to feel him, to know him, to perceive him more deeply, more profoundly. But also may we realize and may we come to know Christ in each other, that we by experiencing each other through the bonds of fellowship. Indeed, may the body of Christ be increased and strengthened by our gathering this afternoon. You know, before I continue, I do want to say thank you also to Father Alessandro. I deal with a lot of priests, as he indicated. I deal with a lot of priests both at the beginning of their time at seminary. People invite me out like this to come and speak. I deal with all sorts of canonical matters. I deal with all sorts of priests. It's always refreshing to deal with one so organized, so nice. He says, this is what I want. It's like, great. There are no hidden mysteries. There are nothing there. It's just always, it's very nice to deal with people such as this. I have to say, he mentioned my father, Father Dan. And before Sandro and Anna came to, Father Alessandro, and Anna came to the seminary, he called me and he kept calling me and kept calling me and saying, now you wait, Alexander. When Sandro and Anna come, they're gonna be great. They're going to be such wonderful students. And indeed, Sandro was a great student, a great presence on campus. People still talk about him in such glowing terms. And for Anna, especially, I have a nice relationship with her because she was one of the babysitters of my children. And you don't just entrust your children to anybody, but she did, and she cared for my kids that enabled me to teach, to do all of the things that Sandro was saying. And to this day, my kids still reckon her as one of the greatest. And my daughter, especially Maria, was jealous that I was coming here and seeing Anna. She was like, oh, Sandro, yeah, okay, that's fine, but Anna. So thank you both. It's nice to see both of you. And thank you, Father Alessandro, for inviting me to come back, to come here and see you. But the members of the community that especially contribute to exercise stewardship, I would like to say thank you for occasioning this opportunity, putting out money, because it obviously costs money to put events like this on. I come from New York, you know, all of these things. And to those, as I say, exercise stewardship for such an occasion, we should all thank, we should all be grateful for moments like this, to allow such encounters, such gatherings. And I would pray God that my words today are in line with what they intended their money to be used for. That our gathering, that this occasion for us to discuss, are exactly the kind of things that we use money for, the money that we work hard for, that we do all sorts of things for, we make sacrifices for, that we in turn sacrifice to God. Again, may God bless all of those people who offered money, who offered time, who offered effort for this afternoon's event to come off. Anyway, as Father Sandra said, I'm Alexander Rentel. I am from Ohio, but I'm from Columbus. So it's not exactly Cleveland, but, and in fact, I was not born in Pennsylvania, but I was born in Pittsburgh. So there are all sorts of rivalries going on. I hope that none of you hold that against me, that I was from that other city in Ohio, down 71, and from that rival city, Pittsburgh. I'm a professor at St. Vladimir Seminary. As Father said, also, you know, that's where I live, where my family, we're there. We live one step off the main driveway. Of the seminary. If you've ever been there, kind of know the layout, well, I live right there. Never feels quite like I leave work, downside, but the upside is I have no commute. I don't have to worry about such things, and living in New York, your commute is a very important thing. One of the upsides, one of the things, of course, I don't want to emphasize today is being a professor at St. Vladimir Seminary enables me to go to a lot of chapel services. Yeah, We have chapel services two, sometimes three times a day, 7 days a week during the academic year. I bring that up not to boast, no, far be it, not to boast, but just to say, I'm going to be speaking today about liturgy and what we do when we do liturgy. And I want to just point out at the outset that these are questions, the kind of questions that I'll be addressing today are the kind of questions that I've thought about myself, to myself, not about myself, to myself, and the answers that I've come to are the answers, in many ways, that I've come to while just sitting in services, hearing psalms, hearing the prayers, hearing the hymns of the church, day in, day out, hour after hour, sometimes nudging, correcting students, sometimes serving them and all of those sorts of things. Father also mentioned, you know, my dad. I started serving with my father, believe it or not, when I was 2.5 years old. It was an occasion for my mom. My mom thought it fitting to put me with my father to have some of that together time. And I was 2.5 years old, put me on the side of the altar. I say that again, not to boast, not to brag, but just to point out that I've been involved for some 46 and a half years. You can do the math how old I am. 46 and a half years of serving in one capacity or another in the church. I've sung in the choir, I've read, I've been a seminarian, I've served in the altar, I've been a deacon, I was a deacon for 4.5 years, I've been a priest now for some 14 years. So again, some of the questions that I'll be posing today and discussing, I've posed, I've formed, while I've been very formally involved in church's liturgical life. And again, the answers that I put forward to you today are answers that I've come to through this formal engagement in the church as one of its servers. Father also mentioned, you know, I went to St. Vladimir Seminary, but then after I went to St. Vladimir Seminary, I wanted to study the liturgical tradition of the church in a very formal academic way. I wanted to study it. I was curious about it in a manner of studying that was not different from the way I would do things in college. So in a history class in college, professor would write things up on the board and you had to scientific sort of study about historical events or dates. Like, I wanted to memorize those facts. I wanted to know where these services came from. I remember very distinctly when I was at the Ohio State Library one year, I don't know, must have been a freshman, so this would have been in the late 80s, freshman or junior, and I actually saw a book on the library shelf that was about the history of the liturgy. And I remember opening it going, oh my gosh. You mean you could study this, you know, as a real scientific, academic, you know, discipline? Indeed, you can. It's hard to do it in the United States, so I went abroad and I studied with a Roman Catholic priest, Father Robert Taft. He's a Jesuit, but he's perhaps the foremost leading scholar from the late 20th and the first part of the 21st century on the history of our liturgical tradition. And I went there and I studied. I say that again, not to boast, but simply to point out. These are, again, questions and answers that I've tried to think about myself, that have been raised, that I have thought about, and answers, again, that I've tried to come to through very formal manner, academic, formal ways as a servant of the church, but then also as a believer, somebody who goes to a lot of church, go to a lot of services. This is what I want to. These are the kind of things that will be coming up today. It's the fruit of a lot of personal reflection. I would even go so far as to say, attending a lot of services, my earliest memories are being in church, serving with my father, my childhood, traveling with my seeing my grandparents and whatnot. This is just where my life has been. What are the questions then that I want to speak about that I've been alluding to? The questions that I'll be posing today and trying to answer for you, or try and lead in discussion, to kind of offer a roadmap for you at this point where I want to go, the first part and then the second part, is I'd just like to talk about what is liturgy. It seems straightforward. It's a bunch of services that we go to, Father. That's easy. Full stop. I'd like to talk about that a little bit more in depth. And instead of saying simply, what is liturgy, and then answer it by, it's a bunch of services, I'd like to try and answer it by saying, well, what do we do when we do liturgy? What do we do? Yeah, talk about that. And then even further, what are we doing when we're doing liturgy? Yeah. Put it another way, without being overly technical, and this is going to be the only foray, I promise you, this will be the only time that I get really technical on you. So just, it's at the beginning of the talk, your energy level is still high. I haven't bored you to tears yet. You're still thinking, oh, it's Dad. You're still angry that I'm from Columbus and Pittsburgh or something like that. So stay fresh. The only moment I'm going to be technical. So there's a word in Greek. And maybe you've already started glossing your eyes over. Maybe you've already closed your ears. But bear with me for just a moment. There's a word in Greek. And it's called typikon. And that word typikon is what the word we get in English, typical. Yeah, it's important. And the word typikon is also used in a liturgical book. Yeah, and it's a book that says how you put all of the services together. Not if I lost anybody on this. Anyway, the word typikon, it's a book, it's a word we get typical from, and typical is a good resonance for that word. It's a good way of understanding that word. But you know, in the original sense of that word typikon, it literally means a stamp, man, of the imprint that something leaves. Yeah? And what I want to talk about is, in many ways, what is that stamp of? Because I don't think that that stamp is just like the liturgical order of services. Perhaps choir director puts forward, or you say to Father Alessandro, you look in a liturgy book and you say, Father Alessandro, what is this part of the service? I don't think that that's what that imprint is of. And I want to talk about then, what is the imprint that is left when that strike is made? When the typikon, what is typical about it? Or what is the type of the typikon? All right? So we can all come back out now. We're going to get comfortable again. No more technical words. So what is liturgy? What do we do? What do we do when we do liturgy? And what are we doing when we do liturgy? These are the questions that I want to put forward. And the second part of what I want to speak about this afternoon, I want to speak about is not only what is the imprint, yeah, I want to talk about what causes that imprint. And another way of perhaps talking about that is, where does our liturgy come from? Where does our liturgical traditions come from? And perhaps some of you already have an idea of that. You have some historical knowledge. Maybe I can add to some of that. Maybe not, but I think I want to point you in some other directions beyond just a historical answer of that. It's not just, oh, our liturgy came from so-and-so and such-and-so. Anyway, the questions. Now, like, get to some answers. Yeah? As I've indicated, these are questions that I'm raising today, and I've sought about these answers for some 45 years in different ways, and from very different perspectives, formal and informal. But I think for many people, not just me, yeah, but I think many people, the answers to these questions are something that many of us feel. Yeah, we have an innate understanding of. Yeah. Most people just do liturgy. They come to a parish church. They go to the liturgical services, the divine liturgy, vespers. They come, and there's an innate understanding of what is going on. They feel the answer to this question. You know, the kind of very typical answer that is often put forward in the churches. And my grandmother, she knew everything about you needed to know about the church because she went to the services. My grandfather was a very pious man. He was a coal miner, steel mill, something like this. But he knew what was going on. I don't discount any of that. I think that there's something very true about that. And I think for many people gathered here, just by your desire to learn a little bit more, you've already indicated that you already want to know more. And that desire to want to know more often means that you do know a little bit more. Yeah? Without a doubt, in other words, this is true, that we can have an innate and easy feeling of what liturgy is and what we do when we celebrate the liturgy. I'm a professor, though, a seminary professor, and I would challenge you at the outset, and I would actually urge you to go further. And I think just, again, by coming today, you do want to go further. And I would say that it's not only go further, but step past feelings and impressions and just some ideas, and start to put words on these feelings. Yeah? Foster a greater understanding, which in turn, I believe, leads to better participation, which in turn leads, I think, to greater knowledge of God. And That greater knowledge of God leads ultimately to our salvation. Further, I think without a knowledge, without an understanding about anything, we always run the risk of going into aberration. So, examples I always like to give about the celebration of liturgy. Just imagine, watching football, right? And if you knew nothing about the game of football, maybe there's some of you American football father, if you know nothing about the game of football, imagine how easily you could misunderstand what the point of the game is about. You know, the point of the game is those times when they go into the huddle. Yeah? Or the point of the game is to make room for timeouts. Or the point of the game is, you know, who knows what. Without knowing at least the rudimentary, or having a rudimentary understanding of the rules or the purpose of the game, you might miss appreciation of the game. You might grasp after a while, you know, some things, the point of the game. But understanding it more and more helps you understand it more and more. Dancing is another thing that's very similar. I'm not a big fan of dance. It's a conflict between my wife and me. She would like to, you know, maybe go see, take advantage of some of the cultural events in New York City and go see a dance, go see ballet or things like that. I find that very challenging to understand. To me, I look at dance on TV or ballet, and I just see people leaping up and down, running across the stage. To my daughter, to my wife, they see something of great beauty. They have a good understanding of what's going on. To some of my daughter's friends who study dance or actually studying ballet, you hear them talk about it, I'm missing quite a bit. Yeah? Okay, I'm willing. I'm willing to miss that. But again, I think my basic point is you can, or maybe not, have a basic understanding, a basic appreciation, but if you know a little bit more, if you understand that much more about what somebody is doing, you have a greater appreciation. So even though any of you gathered here today might have that basic understanding of what liturgy is, what we're doing when we do liturgy, etc., it's always good to know a little bit more. Yeah. To show this point, though, I would like to have just a very quick exercise at the beginning. Everybody stand up, we'll do some jumping. No, just kidding. No, just stay down. I would like to have an exercise. And to do this, I would just ask everybody to bear with me. Yeah? And I would just, everybody where you are, I would like you to just close your eyes for just a minute. Here, I'm being serious. I would just like you to close your eyes and try and get to a very calm place. I'm going to speak for just a little bit, and then I'm going to be quiet. And in all calmness, on this busy Saturday afternoon, don't think about what needs to happen yet, what has happened, the kind of things that have to happen this weekend before you return to work or domestic obligations. But in quiet, in calmness, in your mind, in the silence of your mind, and in peace and love in our hearts, I'd like you to just for a moment put aside all doubts about your faith, about the existence of God, or summon the faith that you have deep within you, okay? And there, in that kind of mindset, in that frame, go back to a place, to a time when you encountered God, not necessarily even in church, the birth of a child, marriage, standing on a beach, watching the ocean, climbing a mountain, Yosemite, seeing Half Dome, flying high in the sky, and great sadness at the death of a loved one, when you felt something transcendent, something inexplicable. Yeah? Just take for a minute and consider that memory. Now with that memory, just take and draw near to that memory and refresh yourself, remind yourself of what it was like, of that feeling, that experience. And in this quietness, the stillness without any doubt about God, about his existence, and in the limits of our human, mortal, sometimes depraved, unfortunately so, existence, and with the ability that we have acquired as humans and been given, strain forward, lean forward, to see, to behold, the immortal and divine Word of God. and consider that all that was revealed to you at that moment, fleeting or an extended moment. All right, we can come back to me now for just a moment. I would ask you, what was your reaction, yeah? And I would say for the most part, you know, the reaction that we have, that feeling that we have, this is liturgy. That's the liturgical celebration right there. Liturgy, and it's a basic equation of liturgy. I'm not a math genius. Any math problems, I go to my son. Any addition, any subtraction, I'm proud that I'm just able to still help my eighth grade daughter do math, but she's just passing by. So it seems kind of silly for me to say, we use words like equation, but it's like a mathematical equation, simple and straightforward. Revelation that we receive from God, our reaction equals liturgy. Receiving the revelation of God, our reaction equals the celebration of liturgy. In other words, let's further put words on this encounter. Yeah, you have in your mind and that quietness that you recalled, yeah? And let's explain it. But remember, there's almost always this some sort of basic equation that has to be, that explains so much. So whether you heard something, whether you behold something, whether you receive something, whether you witness something, plus your response, that's it. That's the liturgical life of our church. So above all, I would say, then, to answer that first question, what is liturgy? Yeah, I would say liturgy is our response to God. Which would take us then, why liturgy? Well, because God loves us. In other words, why are we even having this discussion today? Why go through any of the liturgical rites? Because God loves us, and he has revealed himself to us because of his love. So this is, in that quietness of your mind, that I ask you to go to, yeah? That moment, that's the moment when God spoke with you. That's the moment that God, you had an encounter. It is a word, an eternal word spoken to you, it was revealed to you, something you beheld. Now, consider that. Just hold that, please hold that as a premise, yeah? Please hold that as a premise, that that's some sort of encounter and a revelation. And let's consider further, some further aspects of that. Yeah? Hold this on one hand for just a moment. So consider the following. Before we totally agree on this, I've asked you just to hold this as an hypothesis. For God to be God, he must be truly other, distinct. He cannot be like us, because then he is one of us. And if he's so much like us, then he's really just our creation or something that we've created in our mind. But rather, again and again, we say, God is holy, holy, holy. Yeah? And holy is not a great big technical word. It just means distinct, distinct, distinct. Other, other, other. Yeah? Completely different, completely different, completely different. That's all the word holy means. He's different, distinct from all other human, from humans, from all creation. But also one of the aspects of being holy in there, the holiness of God, also speaks about him being unchangeable. Yeah? God knows no change. Yeah? From before eternity to the end of time, God is the same. Distinct from us. In fact, he knows no time. There's no change. Our understanding of him might change, but that's something different. Yeah? God is also unknowable. How can we, as his creatures, begin to grasp him, begin to understand him? He cannot be understood in any way, because as soon as we understand him, as soon as we start knowing him, we essentially start putting limits around him. We circumscribe him with a circle of our knowledge. So he's completely distinct, before time, outside of time, after time. And again, anything else, then we would be essentially limiting God. We would be confining him. It would not be something other, something distinct, but something we ourselves would be creating. Okay? But remember, I trust you. And I trust that when you entered into the quietness of your mind, you recalled an experience. You recalled a time, a place. You closed your eyes and you recalled something, you heard something, you remembered something. But how can this be? How can this be truly divine if God is so distinct, so other, so holy? The answer is simple. Because he has chosen to make himself known. He has chosen out of his love and out of his goodness. And if God is love, as Scripture tells us, if God is good, something we say many times in the church, if his goodness, if his love is authentic and true, and God forbid that they're not, then he could not keep his love and his goodness to himself. Otherwise, it would not be authentic love. It would not be authentic goodness. But he could only share these things. He can only reveal these things to us, himself to us, his love, his goodness, and himself to us. Fathers of the church, in fact, say that the only thing that compels God, the only thing that is that God is compelled by, is his goodness to reveal himself to us. Otherwise, he's keeping himself to himself. And how is that good? So again, my basic mathematical formula. Yeah, God loves us. He has revealed that love to us. And our liturgy is that response to his love. But again, this is the basic sort of equation of the liturgical celebrations. Out of his goodness, out of his love for us, he has chosen to reveal himself to us. Now, the basic formula I would put forward, if you're familiar with the scripture, is repeated many, many times. Many, many times in the Psalms and in other places in the liturgy or in the biblical text. So, if you take, for example, Psalm 103, verse 2, we hear this all the time in the liturgical services. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Just think about that. Forget not all his benefits. What we're required to do in this instance is call to mind, and bless is our response. We'll talk a little bit more about what those words mean in just a minute. But think of that basic formula. Remember all that God has done. And how do we remember? Because he's revealed something to us. He's shown himself to us. Talk about how he does that in just a moment. And our response is blessing him. Or consider Psalm 106, verse 1, the first verse. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His mercy endures forever. There again, it's exactly what I've been saying. And you could almost put a resultant clause in there a little bit better. Give thanks to the Lord. Why? Because he is good and his mercy endures forever. How do we know that he is good? How do we know that his mercy endures forever? Well, how do we know that he's good? Because we remember that. We don't forget it. And as we will see just in a moment, we recall it. We come to know God again and again throughout the liturgical services. How do we know that his mercy endures forever? Because we experience it. We experience it in our day-to-day lives. And that's exactly what I've asked you to sum up. These words, though, give thanks, bless the Lord, throughout the Bible, the Bible uses any number of words, kind of in many ways synonymously. What we do in liturgy. Just think about these from your experience in church. I've said bless, thanks, but think also about praise, yeah? One of the words that we hear how many times in the liturgical services, glory, yeah? We ascribe glory to God. We confess his name, another word that's used often in the Psalms. All of these speak, in other words, about our response and actually start putting flesh on what we're doing, the kind of thing that we feel innately, yeah? We're blessing God. We're thanking God. We're praising God. We're worshiping God. Yeah? Think about it just in the celebration of the Divine Liturgy during the Anaphora when the priest is saying the great prayer of the church, and right after he elevates the gifts and says, thine own of thine own we offer unto thee on behalf of all and for all. Yeah? We're doing something. Recognizing that God has done something, continues to do something for us, and we, the entire people and gathered in the church, respond back exactly. Yeah? We praise thee, we bless thee, We give thanks to thee, O Lord, and we pray to thee, O our God. That's before us, celebrated right there in our midst. Yeah, this basic pattern, this basic type, the imprint, as I mentioned at the outset. Now, the Lord's love is described in various ways, so that it's not just, you know, I love you, the kind of thing I say to my wife, to my children, you know, to we hear on TV, the movies, the kind of thing you read in a magazine, you know, I love you, Cindy, I love you, Marianne, I love you, Bobby. It's not a love, you know, akin to that. You hope it's true love, you hope it's authentic love. I hope that when I say that to my wife and my children, I mean it. I think I do, such things. But our Lord's love especially is not, in other words, it's not just something undefined, left floating out there, left hanging out there. In fact, it's defined. And again, words are given to it. Mm-hmm. Meaning is ascribed to it. So think especially about the way the Lord's love is described in the Bible. Mm-hmm. Some of the ways, of course, first and foremost, the Lord, God's love for us is described especially in the way he intervened in history and redeemed the people of Israel. In other words, he intervened in history and in the lives of the people of Israel, the ancient Hebrews of old. Yeah? So, Psalm 135, verse 4. Yeah? For the Lord has chosen Jacob, Israel as his own possession. Yeah? In other words, give thanks to the Lord because the Lord has chosen Jacob, Israel as his possession. His love is in particularly described in that intervening in the life of Israel because he chose them. For whatever reason, those were his chosen people. And further, it's not just, I choose you, but now I will deliver you. I will bring you out of slavery. I will put you in your own land. Yeah? And he even says, I will be your king. Yeah? So, before we get to the getting into the land and all of those other things, the Bible also describes the full extent, the full range of God's love, especially for his people. It's a beautiful psalm. Look in the Bible. I'm giving you these verses. If you write them down, if you don't have a chance to write them down, you want to ask me, I can tell you them all. Psalm 136, the whole psalm practically, verses 1 through 26. There are a whole series of injunctions to give thanks to the Lord. And in each instance, it's a give thanks to the Lord because he did this. Give thanks to the Lord, he did that. Give thanks to the Lord because he did this and that. Yeah? And above all, it's because he is good. His mercy endures forever. As is demonstrated, is revealed in a whole long list of things that he did involving, I mean, just think about it. If you have a basic sort of knowledge about the Old Testament, about, you know, our faith, he redeemed his people of Israel. He delivered them. He did various actions, activities, deeds, works by which he saved the people of Israel, brought them out of Egypt, through the Red Sea, through the desert, and brought them into the own land. So how is God's love above all is expressed? And think of the words, the words that have come forward. You have, of course, deliverance, Exodus, the freedom from bondage, going so far as to give the very food for the people that they needed there in the wilderness. So again, it's not just love, but the words that are expressed involve the very real life of these people. And their activity, their experience is, of course, the sorts of things that we experience, or that we express in thanks and in gratitude to our very day, in our very own lives. Because indeed, God offers us deliverance. He offers us freedom. He offers us the very basic necessities of life. And it's in the face of all of these things that we ourselves give thanks. Now, note carefully what I've been doing, and I'm trying to do this somewhat surreptitiously, not sneakily or anything like that, but note very carefully what I've been doing, what I've been trying to do here in this. I'm using the words from the Psalms and from the Scriptures above all to give words, yeah, to try and explain what we're doing, because this is what the church does. One of the things that we do in liturgy is take those words, take those experiences, take those stories, Take these tales of God's activity and make them ours. Yeah? This is our story. This is our history. This is our life. This is how we understand ourselves now. Yeah? The Bible gives us words, shapes, further nuances to our life, to our words, to our activities, to our deeds, to our works, words, to our life. Yeah? And this is how we ourselves see things. Yeah? A word on just very quickly why that's important. Because as we will see, our life in the church, our life with God, involves our life with Christ. It's not with God, amorphous and unknowing. But remember, all of this is predicated on us knowing God, coming to know God. And above all, how do we know God? Through the person of his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. And if we don't use words, thoughts, images, the stories, the things that have been handed down for us, then again, we have the possibility of going into temptation. We have the possibility of knowing things that are not of God. We have the possibility of not coming to the truth. But in fact, through using and understanding who God is, how he has revealed himself to us, by Scripture above all, we come to a greater and more profound knowledge of what has been revealed to us. I lied earlier. I'm going to use another big technical word. I'm sorry. I made a mistake. But use another word. And again, bear with me on this. It's not a completely foreign word to the English language, but the way I'm going to use it might require some introduction. But again, through the use of the Scripture, we come to a greater knowledge. Okay? I think we can all appreciate that. And one of the things that the Apostle Paul speaks about and that is used in other places in Scripture is to talk about this revelation, this coming to knowledge, as the revelation of a mystery. Yeah? Now, it's a technical word in the sense that it's not a mystery of who done it. You know, I brought you all here to tell you that Father Alessandro did it. He had the candlestick in the chancery, obviously. You know, no, it's not a mystery like that. But it's a mystery in the sense of something that is not immediately apparent. Yeah? The meaning, the understanding of that is something that has to be uncovered, that has to be understood. Yeah? St. Mary of Egypt. There's an icon of St. Mary of Egypt over there. A great beloved saint of the church. And this is an example of mystery. Yeah? St. Mary of Egypt, if people don't know her life, explain it just very quickly. St. Mary of Egypt came from Egypt, obviously. She was a prostitute. She lived her life very poorly, yeah, in pursuit of all sorts of sexual gratification. And one day she heard of a boat going from Alexandria to Jerusalem on pilgrimage. She snuck aboard the boat. And in order to pay her way, she performed favors, shall we say, on the boat, corrupting pilgrims along the way. She got to Jerusalem and was prevented from entering one of the churches for the Feast of the Exaltation of the Cross. She was prevented by the Mother of God, the Theotokos, from entering the church. She received a revelation. And the revelation told her to go off into the desert. And 14 years, she was in the desert before she was discovered by a priest from one of the monasteries in Palestine, Elder Zosima. Yeah. And she told a story to him, yeah, because before she went into the desert, she didn't encounter anybody else. She told a story to him of her life. Mm-hmm. Now, just think about that in the context of what I mean by mystery. Yeah. How in the world does a prostitute who corrupts pilgrims along the way to the Holy Land serve to reveal to us our faith? Yeah. It requires some understanding of what she did. It requires some understanding of what further happened to her. Yeah? And the fact that we hold her up as a great example in our lives requires a certain change of our mind. It requires coming to knowledge. It involves unraveling, unfurling this mystery. Yeah? Let's be even blunter about unfurling the mystery. Yeah? If you had a troublemaking religious figure from many years ago who kind of went around the area and gave a bunch of preachings and talked about things, and they didn't square officially with Orthodoxy as it was considered at the time. And he did some very odd events like spitting in a person's mouth or picking up dirt from the ground, making mud and putting it in people's eyes. Yeah. If at one certain point he went and took a whip into a church and cast out all the money, yeah, and he started pointing at this church and said, "I will tear down that building." Yeah, or that's at least what people heard. Yeah, if he made all sorts of strange comments about the religious establishment, if he said, "If your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. If your hand, cut it off." And then you saw him put to death in a brutal way. How would you understand that? Now, of course, I hope you know who I'm talking about. That's what I mean by mystery of faith. Now, when I say it requires uncovering, discovering, learning, coming to greater knowledge, it's the kind of thing many of us do, again, without even thinking. But again, I would challenge everybody in this room to think about how it has to go on further. How you have to go in more. If anybody's ever opened the Bible to a random page, yeah, you know, often it takes a little bit of time to think, you know, go, "Hey, Father Alessandro, what does this obscure passage in the New Testament mean?" Yeah? This is what I mean about the mystery of our faith. It has to be understood, it has to be uncovered. It requires work. Yeah? Sometimes things happen unconsciously, yeah, but sometimes it requires real work. Okay, back to liturgy. Yeah? Quite a bit of liturgy is presenting us with the mystery of our salvation, of who Jesus Christ is. And part of our work in liturgy is uncovering that mystery and coming to a greater and greater and greater understanding of what that mystery means. So, in a passage like this, with this idea of coming to greater knowledge, with an idea of this, of the liturgical services as something coming to a greater and greater knowledge, I would remind you of a verse like Psalm 50, chapter 23, which commands that we offer God. God actually speaks through the prophet, the psalmist, and says, "Offer to me a sacrifice of thanksgiving." So we do. We offered him a sacrifice of thanksgiving. Father Alessandro, there are no lambs offered here. There are no birds like the temples of old. There's not a bread sacrifice that burned in a fire within things like that. We offer a sacrifice of thanksgiving and the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. We enter into that, a sacrifice that happened once for all. But above all, we offer a sacrifice of thanksgiving. We say thank you to God. Now, and in that liturgical sacrifice, in what we're doing, according to the psalmist, God says, "And in that sacrifice of thanksgiving, I will make my salvation known." So there's something about coming to the services, praising God, entering into this revelation about Jesus Christ that brings us further to knowledge. And that knowledge increases, as that knowledge increases within us, we enter and come ever closer to eternal life. Think about John chapter 17, 13. And the great prayer that Christ offers before his crucifixion, he says in his prayer, "And this is eternal life." Just pause for a minute, even if you know the next line. Yeah, what do you think eternal life is? What is heaven? And there are so many things that people pass around about what heaven is, and we hear about what other faiths say. You know. Impossible for us to say. Something my kids like to ask me, "What will heaven be like, Dad?" We didn't cover that in class. I don't know. I don't teach it, so I don't teach that class. So I go ask one of the other priests. Heaven is in many ways, you know, not a structure. It's not a place where one big family reunion, one big party. You always hear this when a musician dies. They say, "Oh, one long jam session, you know, kind of in the sky," or, you know, "He'll be doing what he always did in life." Well, what our Lord says, one of the few things that the Lord says about heaven, he says, and this is eternal life, that they know thee, the only God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. It's one of the few places where Jesus actually says, this is what eternal life is going to be. So I want you to keep that in mind, because I'm going to come back to this point. But part of what we do in liturgy is enter into eternal life as we develop a greater and greater and come to a more profound knowledge of who Jesus is, Christ, and through him, our Heavenly Father. We enter into eternal life. This is true knowledge. This is knowledge that is salvific. It comes to us in the revelation of the mystery that is unfurled, if you will, before us, which requires us to do something. And I said this already, and I'm going to say it again. It requires us to do something further in liturgy. Uncover. Perceive. Come to an understanding. And here faith is key in that work. We do not, again, worship God, unknowable, or made in our image. But in the liturgy, we come to know Jesus Christ. We come to know him and the revelation that he has offered us. And above all, where is that revelation given to us? The scripture. Yeah? The scriptures form the backbone and our understanding, our framework of what and who Jesus Christ is. The end of Luke's gospel, Luke chapter 24, verses 25 and 27 and so on. Jesus is one of my favorite passages in the whole Bible. It's after the resurrection. Two of his disciples are walking to the village of Emmaus, which is some short distance from Jerusalem. And they're discouraged because they didn't quite know and didn't quite understand the mystery that took place there in Jerusalem. And they're walking along, and a stranger comes to them, and he says, what's the matter? And they say, are you the only one in Jerusalem who didn't hear what happened? You know? And they explain to him, and he seems to go on further after they've reached their destination, but the Bible says they constrained him. He sat down, he broke bread with them. And then he says, when they're still expressing that they didn't quite get the mystery, he says, oh, foolish men, was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted scriptures, all things concerning himself. So we're coming into the services, our understanding of the scripture leads us into a knowledge, and our knowledge brings us closer to who Jesus Christ is. We come through to know these texts, our Lord, all that he has done for us. And we come to know even further that when those passages that I spoke about earlier, give thanks to the Lord for he is good, his mercy endures forever, that good thing, those good things that Jesus Christ did above all, was enter into his death and his resurrection. Above all, that basic mystery of the faith that we come to know is that our Lord is risen from the dead. It's a central element. And think even further, that coming to the knowledge of Jesus Christ, coming to church, coming to the services, all of these things that we do, every single thing that we do in the church, is in many ways encapsulated in one of the most important verses in the whole New Testament. Here, John 20, verse 30. These things were written, the gospel tells us. These things, John wrote in the gospel. These things were written so that you might believe. So that you might believe. Because belief in Jesus Christ, coming to know him, takes us far from disbelief, far from anxiety, far from all of these things, far from a worldly existence, and takes us into eternal life. Now, so as I say, all of this, all of what we do in the church, all of what we're doing in the liturgical services, it's scripturally based. And what we're doing is unraveling the mystery of Christ before us, grasping, understanding, receiving the revelation as it is done through the words that bind us as Christians. Scripture, yeah? But note that all of these things, as I say, point to Jesus Christ. And liturgically interpreting them and proclaiming them points again and again to him. I've already read that one passage from Luke, from John, but another passage from Luke. Luke 24:35 speaks about how Jesus, those two disciples walking down, Jesus comes, constrain him, how he made known to, how he made himself known to them in the breaking of the bread. Yeah? Tomorrow we'll celebrate liturgy. Father Alessandro will break the bread. You'll receive that bread. And in the breaking of that bread, yeah, you'll come to know Jesus Christ. Yeah? What are you doing in liturgy? Coming to know Jesus Christ as that bread is broken. Our Lord even spoke this way. So this is, to turn my book over, excuse me. The Lord even spoke about this way, about what he was doing. Consider his words at the Last Supper in Luke 22:19. He says, do this in remembrance of me. Tomorrow morning, we'll do that in remembrance of him. What we do, in other words, will be remembrance of him. And remembering him will respond to that. Or consider the words of the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 16. He says, the cup of blessing which we bless, is that not participation in the blood of Christ? The bread in the body of Christ? Think about that. What we're doing, liturgy, is participating in the very basic, central mystery of Jesus Christ. Enumerated so many times in the Bible, in the scriptures, and in what we do. So, all of these scriptural texts, coming to know Jesus, the centrality of the faith, through that liturgical work that we do, that all of this has made sense, that this understanding is given over to us. One of my favorite passages in all of the, in the book of Psalms, is from the 73rd Psalm. And the psalmist really gives voice in many ways to so many things that I think of. And I'll be honest with you. I've said I'm in church, I've served in the church, I've studied the church, I live at a church, practically. My life is devoted to service of the church. But it's not hard to give in to some sort of doubts. It's not hard to look at other people and say, you know, why do they have it so easy? Why am I doing X, Y, and Z when so much of their life seems easier? And it's easy sometimes to even give in to temptation to say, even better. Read Psalm 73 once. You know, take it home, open the Bible. I'm sure if you don't have a Bible at home, you can look it up online. Go to Barnes & Noble. They have walls of Bibles nowadays. Bible for every occasion. Men's Bibles, girls' Bibles, children's Bibles, graduation Bibles, city Bibles, country Bibles. I mean, they've got everything you ever need. Psalm 73, yeah? The psalmist is struggling, and he's looking around the world that he knew, and he's saying, Lord, I do not understand. Like the evil, they look so sleek. They seem so successful. And he starts talking to himself. He has kind of an interior monologue, and he's wrestling with the basic questions. And he says, I don't understand. And where does he get understanding? The punchline is, he goes into the sanctuary, into the temple, into the liturgical assembly of the ancient Hebrews, no doubt. And he understands everything, and he perceives their end. He understands that what is given over to us in the mystery of Christ, in the mystery of our salvation, is something far eternal, something transcendent. It is not earthbound, but it is, of course, leads us up to heaven. He says, I went into the sanctuary and perceived their end, and by extension, our end. Psalm 48, verses 9 through 10, also expresses something so basic about what we do when we come to the liturgy. We have thought on thy mercy, O God, in the midst of the temple. Yeah? And I love that. Just think about this tomorrow. Think about this quote tonight. Stay for Vespers tomorrow morning when you go to the celebration of the liturgy. And say, just put these words, your own words, okay? And he says, we thought on thy mercy, O God, in the midst of thy temple. Everything I've been saying up to this point is you think exactly what we're doing in the liturgy. You think about God's mercy. Think about what he's done to you personally, but think about what he's done for all of us in his great mystery. Yeah. But the psalmist doesn't just stop there. He doesn't say, oh, yeah. But that thinking of the mercy of God allows all of a sudden for the walls of the church to just disappear. the roof to go wherever, and the whole world to be transformed. And he says, so I'm going to read the whole quote now. We have thought on thy mercy, O God, in the midst of thy temple. And then he says, as thy name, O God, so thy praise reaches the ends of the earth. Yeah? It's an extraordinary two lines. It's, there are no walls, there are no ceiling. There's just the entire cosmos, the entire world. Contemplating the mercy of God takes us, allows us, grabs us, removes us into something far greater, something that extends from the end to the end of, end to end of the world, indeed to the end and end of the universe. It's an extraordinary moment. Now, I've said when you go to church tomorrow, and I've said what the Lord has done to each of us, but there's something else that we do when we come into liturgy. So the kind of things that we've talked about up to this point, what we do when we come to liturgy, we respond to God's mercy, to his love. We recall, we remember, we enter into the mystery. Yeah. One other thing, one further thing, that we do when we come to liturgy is we come together. Yeah, we come together. It's not just me, Father Alexander, coming into the liturgical services and saying, this is great. It's all for me. It is all for me. But even more important, it's all for me through everybody else. So there's the assembly. There's another activity that we do when we do liturgy. We come together as a church. It is not my faith. It's not your scripture. It's not his or her knowledge. Yeah, but it's something we all share. It is our faith, our scripture, our knowledge. It comes from God and is for each and every one of us. Now I have a longer quote here, just from 1 John, epistle, 1 John. This is the first chapter, verses 1 through 3. Perhaps you know it. Just going to read it again. Bear with me. I've tried not to have too many lengthy quotes, but I think that this brings up much of what we've spoken about. So, that which we have heard from the beginning, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon and touched with our hands concerning the word of life. The life was made manifest. We saw it and testified to it and proclaimed to you the eternal life which was with the Father and was made manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim. Now, all of these things that the Apostle John is speaking about, in many ways what I've been speaking about, what we heard, what we have seen. And just think about what we do in the liturgical year. We see things from the beginning. We're coming up, I can't even imagine, we're coming up very quickly on the Feast of the Nativity. That which was from the beginning. Once you get through the Nativity, you come to Theophany, the baptism. And at least at seminary, we start rounding a corner very quickly towards Lent and the celebration of Pascha. Yeah? That which we have seen from the beginning, taking us all the way to Pascha. And think about how we do things in liturgy. We hear them. We see them with our eyes. Father brings a censer around. We smell them. Perhaps we move with our body as we draw forward. We taste all of these things that the Apostle John is speaking about. So again, that which we have seen, that which we have heard, that which we have touched from the beginning. Then he goes on, which we have seen and heard, we proclaim. That's something we're doing in the services. We respond to that. Okay, we've got that. Also to you, and here we come, so that you might have fellowship with us. Yeah? So that you might have fellowship with us. Exactly when we recall, when we remember, when we respond, because we are responding to the same thing, we are assembling together as the chosen of God, as his body, as his church. People who share faith, people who share being delivered, people who share being aided, people who share, how do you want to say this, having experienced God's mercy. But the apostle goes further, that you might have fellowship with us, and that our fellowship is with the Father and his Son, Jesus Christ. All that we do in liturgy makes us a group, common fellowship, the very body of Jesus Christ, the household of his faith, using all of these images from the Apostle Paul. Notice too that with this fellowship with us and with God and with those who come before us, as in this quote, we make known all that God has done. Yeah? We make known to all that God has done, things that have been passed down. The Apostle James is saying, we have testified. He speaks as somebody who witnessed. Yeah? He's testifying to us, down from the apostolic age to our very days. Yeah? From the first part of the first century in Palestine, down to the first part of the 21st century here in Olmsted Falls, yeah, Ohio. That testimony is the same. And one of the things that we further do in liturgy is not only receive this, respond to this, but we ourselves pass this down. We pass it down to the next generation so that the next generation might not forget, because when people forget in the Bible about all of the things that God has done, I think you know that other equation. If you remember, things go well. If you forget, things go very bad. So, Psalm 102, verses 18 through 22, the psalmist says, "Let this be recorded for a generation to come, so that a people yet unborn may praise the Lord." Yeah? Let this be recorded for a generation to come, so that a people yet unborn may praise the Lord. There it says, why? Again, this is basic formula. God has done something, our response to it. Yeah, our response is praise, glory, thanks, confess, adore, all of these things. Yeah, and it says, so the people may praise God. Why? Because God, the psalmist says, because the Lord looked down from heaven. From his holy height, from heaven, the Lord looked down to the earth to hear the groans of the prisoner and set free those who are condemned to die. Of course, we believe that the psalmist is speaking about saw the day that the Lord would come and free us from death by undergoing death himself, by willingly being crucified, by dying, but being raised from the dead on the third day. Our response, in other words, again, of praise and glory to the knowledge that we receive also forms us as an assembly. Now, in all that I have said, too, there's at least one further activity that needs to occur during the liturgical services. If we truly come to knowledge of God, and from that and to that knowledge we respond with praise and glory, thanks, note that what we're also doing, we're rejecting other things. The signs and wisdom of this world. I talked about Mary of Egypt. If you consider any of the martyrs of the church, who is that in the back? Is that St. Demetrius or St. Pantaleon? Pantaleon. We just celebrated St. John the Baptist, or otherwise obscure figure. I mean, just read the beginning of Mark's Gospel about John the Baptist. He's eating locusts and honey in the desert, wearing camel skin. He's got sandals on. Now, we all say, well, he was John the Baptist. He was a great figure, of course. But just think if you saw somebody, though, in the desert eating bugs and having wild honey and just had some camel skin on. Are you really so sure that in first century Palestine, they didn't go? Saint Demetrius, we just commemorated him on Wednesday in the church. Great martyr of the church, but any of the martyrs could be used as an example in this. We celebrate these great martyrs as heroes of the faith. Yeah, but one of the great points that is driven home in each of their lives is how they were rejected by the world. Yeah, that's the whole point of their martyrdom. They witnessed, they testified to God, and even though they were killed, and oftentimes they were killed in the most gruesome ways. Flayed, stoned, beheaded, pierced with a sword. Demetrius himself was in a prison cell. He had once been a great commander of the Roman army who found his life in a very dark, dank, humid, no doubt gross, disgusting prison cell. And at a certain point, the emperor was so provoked that the soldiers just rushed down the hall and without further consideration, just rammed Demetrius through with spears. Yeah? What an ignoble way to die, according to the world. We celebrate that, though. And remember, by celebrating that, we're rejecting another vision of the world. A vision of the world that puts great weight in the signs and the wisdom of this world. Money, wealth, success, possessions, controversy, hatred, enmity, I don't need to remind everybody about the presidential race. We are rejecting so many things of this world because we are accepting the folly of the cross, which, remember, is a sign that is not logical. That Jesus died on the cross, that the cross is an instrument of our salvation, that we celebrate the cross, that we wear nice jeweled crosses on our chest, that we kiss the cross, that priests make signs of the cross over you and wish you peace. It's a very strange behavior, but we accept it. We accept that vision of the world and what it is, then accept that to be true and not anything else. Yeah? We're rejecting other things, accepting the folly of the cross, which is all we know as Christians. Yeah? We are seeing things in the world, the very universe, the way the universe, as it is meant to be, as God intended it. Yeah? We are able to see things in a manner that is not given over to everybody. But as Christians, we're able to see this. And in order to come to this, I'm arriving now very quickly at that other activity that we do in liturgy. In order to do this, our minds need to change. Yeah? And the word, the scriptural, the liturgical, the churchy word for changing our mind is repent. Repent. Very simple. Change our mind. Reorient our lives so that we can see things, so that we can put value in the things that are not valued of this world, so that we can celebrate the weak, the downtrodden. Just last week in the gospel, we read the gospel for the parable of Lazarus and the rich man. Yeah? Rich man had purple linen. No doubt he stepped over Lazarus gingerly, who was laying at his gate with sores. The dogs licking his things. Oh, gross. I'm going to step around him. Yeah? Who do we celebrate in that story? Yeah? We celebrate Lazarus with the sores, the dogs licking the sores. Yeah? Undeniable, the point of the Lord's gospel is if you do not recognize what is weak, what is considered ill or infirm, what you might otherwise want to pass by in this world, then you're missing the whole point. And for us to grasp that, for us to understand that, requires us to repent. Full stop. Repentance, in other words, is not just coming to confession, although that's a key component. It's not just going to Father Alessandro and saying, you know, I did X, Y, and Z, or I feel this way or that way, or I was hurtful, hateful, or something like that. It's a key component. But repenting is something far more difficult than just providing a list of our sins and receiving spiritual counsel. It's truly changing our mind, changing our lives, and seeing things the way God intends us to see them. Indeed, seeing things the way they truly are. Yeah, Father, I would actually suggest that we maybe take a break at this point. It's a natural sort of break in my talk. We'll come back and I'll offer a few more words on this topic and then kind of get to the point where we are. How do we get to the service? Where do our services come from?